Assalamualaikum brothers and sisters. So this video will be presenting chapter 2, semiconductor materials and diodes. So firstly, let's start with a bit of chemistry, classification of materials. So there are three types of materials. The first one is insulators, materials with very high resistance. Current cannot flow, okay? So when you deal with materials with high resistance, and if you look at the Ohm's law, I is equivalent to V over R. So if R is infinity, what is your I? Your I is zero, right? So that is why for insulators, there is no current. Current will not be able to flow. So examples of insulators are rubber, plastic, glass, and so on, okay? The next material is conductors. Conductors are materials with very low resistance. Current can flow easily because they are conductors, okay? They can conduct current. Examples are copper, aluminium, any types of metals, and steel, okay? So the last material is this unique material known as semiconductors. So semiconductors are neither good conductors nor insulators. For example, you have silicon from group 4 and germanium, okay? So germanium is also from group 4. You can control semiconductors by increasing their resistance to make it insulator, or you can make it as conductors by decreasing their resistance, right? So energy gap is energy difference between the top of the valence band and the bottom of the conduction band. So for conductor, there is no energy gap, so that's why current can flow easily. For insulator, the band gap energy is very wide, alright? So electrons in your valence band will be difficult to jump to the conduction band. However, for semiconductor, there is still a band gap, but if you do something with this semiconductor material, you can reduce the band gap and allow electrons to jump to conduction band and current can flow. So now let's focus on the semiconductor materials and properties. I think you know that an atom is composed of a nucleus, which contains positively charged protons and neutrons, and then you have electrons that orbit the nucleus. Electrons in the outermost shell are called valence electrons, right? So for silicon or germanium, which are from group 4, it means that they have 4 electrons in their outer shells. But in order to become a stable atom, it needs how many more electrons? In total, a stable atom needs 8 electrons at its outermost shell. So basically, silicon or germanium requires another additional 4 electrons. Okay, so this is a silicon, and silicon has 14 electrons, right? So if you count these spinning electrons here, the total is 14. So the outermost shell is known as the valence shell. Okay, so this is my silicon. It has 4 electrons. Let's say it is surrounded by another 4 silicons. So this silicon will go to this particular silicon to create covalence bond. Okay, so this silicon is already a stable atom. Okay, so sharing of electrons occurred, and this bond is known as the covalent bond. So as I mentioned just now, in order to break the covalent bond, a valence electron must gain enough energy to become free electrons. So the minimum energy required is known as the band gap energy, which I have covered earlier. So let's say you increase the temperature of a particular atom, let's say in this case a silicon, the electrons will gain enough energy to jump to the conduction band. So here it is, the illustration when that occurs. So when an electron jump to the conduction band, what happened? It will leave an empty space. Okay, when this electron sees this empty space, it will be tempted to move and fill in that space. And so it will leave another empty space for this electron. Okay, so when one electron becomes free, you will see the movement of electrons in one direction, and you will see empty spaces move in the other direction. Okay, so actually it's the movement of electrons that creates the movement of empty spaces, or you will see later the term holes. Alright, so let's proceed with intrinsic semiconductor. So an intrinsic semiconductor is a single crystal semiconductor material with no other types of atoms within the crystal. Alright, therefore in intrinsic semiconductor, the densities of electrons and holes are equal. which means that the number of electrons and not is equivalent to the number of holes, which is presented as P naught. The notation Ni is used as intrinsic carrier concentration. Okay, so we can use Ni for both holes and electrons. Okay, so the formula to calculate Ni is given as follows. So B is a coefficient related to the specific semiconductor material. Eg is the band gap energy. The temperature, T. Okay, and it is in Kelvin. Remember that Kelvin is equivalent to whatever in degree Celsius plus with 273.15. And maybe you will see another references that use only 273. Doesn't matter. You can use this reference or the other reference, but you must convert to Kelvin. Okay. Then you have the Boltzmann constant, which is equivalent to 86 times 10 to the power of minus 6. This is normally given to you in the question. So now, for the semiconductor materials such as silicon, germanium and gallium arsenide, so these two are the specifications for these materials, band gap energy and the constant B. So let's look at one example. Calculate the intrinsic carrier concentration in silicon at temperature 300K. So in this example, it's just use the formula. So they just put in the values, but please take note that the question specify silicon. So you need to use the silicon specifications, right? Okay, so be careful and look at the material specified in the question. For example, in this case, the question asks for gallium arsenide. Okay, so look at the gallium arsenide specifications. So this is the formula. So what I normally do is, I will calculate this area first. Okay, I'd calculate the one in the parentheses. Okay, and I will get this value, minus 27.13. And then I will do the exponential operation. Okay, and I will get this answer. Alright. And then only I will multiply with 300 to the power of 3 over 2. Okay. And I will get this answer. And then only I will multiply with the constant, 2.1 times 10 to the power of 14. And I will get the answer, 1.8 times 10 to the power of 6. So, it's just a matter of how you key in the values in your calculator. So, these are my steps and it's up to you. You can try to do these steps for this example. And again, the material is silicon. And the temperature is 250 Kelvin. Okay, so have a go and you should get this answer. Alright? So now let's look at extrinsic semiconductor. So you can see in the examples just now, the concentration of intrinsic semiconductor is very small. Okay, so let's say you give a high temperature, you're just going to generate a very small current. Therefore, to increase the number of carriers, you add impurities to the silicon or germanium, and this is what extrinsic semiconductor is all about. So the impurities will be from group 5 and group 3. So why we use these groups? So group 5 will have 5 electrons in the outer shell, right? For example, phosphorus and arsenic. So if you add a group 5 material to a silicon, the silicon will use 4 electrons, right, to be stable, and you have a 5th electron here, extra electron. So this 5th electron are loosely bound to the phosphorus atom. Hence, even at room temperature, the electron has enough energy to break away and become free electrons, as you can see in this animation here. Okay, so let's say one electron becomes free, you have empty space, and these electrons from phosphorus are so excited to fill in the empty spaces. So atoms from group 5 are known as donor impurity because it donates. Okay, so group 5 plus silicon is known as N-type semiconductor, right? So now, as for group 3, you have 3 electrons in the outer shells, right? So the boron will share all 3 of its electrons. However, one of these silicon has not enough electrons. So it will have extra empty space, extra hole. So this is the boron, and you can see the empty space will cause the electrons to fill the empty space. So we have movement of holes due to the movement of electrons. The valence electrons from outer shells are attracted to fill the holes added by the insertion of boron. So atoms from group 3 are known as acceptor because it accepts electrons. Now, group 3 plus silicon or group 3 plus germanium, for example, is known as P-type semiconductor. So remember, group 5 plus silicon is N-type, group 3 plus silicon is P-type. Now, the materials containing impurity atoms are called extrinsic. We have covered that, right? but it is also known as doped semiconductors. The process of adding these impurities is known as the doping process. So you can control the concentrations of electrons and holes, and you can determine the conductivity and current in the materials. Okay, the relation between the electron and hole concentrations in thermal equilibrium is given below, which is N0 multiplied with P0 equivalent to Ni squared. We have defined what is N0 and P0, right? So the product of the electron and hole densities is a constant because it is maintained by the recombination and generation that is occurring at equal rates. So this is a very in-depth semiconductor physics going on. I am not going to cover too much detail into that. So just remember that in thermal equilibrium, the product of electron and hole densities is a constant equivalent to Ni squared. So for N-type, which is semiconductor doped with group 5, electrons are the majority carriers. You have more electrons, right? So the number of electrons in thermal equilibrium denoted by N0, okay, is equivalent to the intrinsic concentration here plus the concentration of the donor atom denoted by ND. And normally ND is much higher than Ni. You just imagine you are adding 1000 plus 1 million. And when you add, you will get the answer approximately equivalent to 1 million. So that 1 million is like your donor atom concentration. So that is how this mathematical operation works. And because you know N0 is approximately equivalent to the donor atom concentration, ND, you can calculate what is P0 using the relationship N0 P0 equivalent to Ni squared. So P0 is equivalent to Ni squared over ND, right? So similarly, for P-type, holes are the majority carriers because you are adding group 3, for example, boron. So similarly, the concentration of Na, the acceptor concentration, is very much higher than the concentration of holes in intrinsic. Similarly, if you add, you will have P0 equivalent to Na, the acceptor concentration. You can calculate the electron concentration in P-type semiconductor using the formula N0 P0 equivalent to Ni squared as well. Right, let's look at one example. In this example, you are asked to calculate the thermal equilibrium of electron and hole concentrations, which means that you are supposed to calculate N0 and P0. Alright, you are given a silicon at 300K doped with phosphorus at the concentration of ND, which is given here, and you are also given what is Ni. So the question does not inform you whether it is N-type or P-type. So what are the clues? The clues are phosphorus and ND, right? So phosphorus is group 5, ND. Look at the word, D means donor. So that is group 5. So that means that you are going to calculate P0 because you know that N0 will be equivalent to the donor concentration, okay? So you calculate P0 equivalent to 2.25 times 10 to the power of 4. Don't forget the unit is density, right? Concentration, cm to the power of minus 3. So this is another example. A silicon is doped with 5 times 10 to the power of 16 arsenic atoms. So again, is the material N-type or P-type semiconductor? So the keyword is arsenic, and arsenic is group 5, and you know the answer is N-type. Then the second part of the question asks you to calculate the electrons and holes concentration of a doped silicon at T equivalent to 300K. So what you need to do is, you know that N0 will be equivalent to ND because we know that it is N-type. And then you need to calculate Ni because Ni is not given in the question. And then you can use the equation P0 equivalent to Ni squared over N0. Alright, so again, have a go. And the answer is given as follows. So I'll see you in the next part of this chapter, which is about the PN junction. Okay, assalamualaikum. Bye.